Measurements strategy. Surface table of the CMM can be used as datum, then we keep the workpiece on that surface, or we can probe the datum. So generally they say probing the datum surface is better. Okay, so that is one step. Then, so you have to, okay, when you are planning, first you have to study the drawing, identify which surface is the datum. So that is why GD&T is really necessary when you are using CMO. Then select workpiece orientation. So how will you keep, which orientation will you keep? How will you place the workpiece on the table? Select work holding method. So how will you hold the workpiece? Then we have to select the stylus and qualification parameters. So what is the stylus diameter, stylus extension, we have to decide. Then the qualification parameters. So when qualifying the stylus, we have to run it at a certain speed. So stylus qualification, we measure the calibration sphere, taking several points, and then from those data, we calculate the position of the stylus and its diameter or radius. So the parameters with which you qualify the stylus, that also should be decided. Then define the sampling strategy. So this is, so you have to take samples on the surface. We are not probing 100%. We cannot take infinite number of points. So we have to select a number of points, a certain number of points on the workpiece surface. How do we select that? So that is called sampling strategy. Then we have to define the measurement parameters. So just like the qualification parameters, measurement parameters are the speed, measuring speed, safety distance, etc., which we have to set up when running the machine. So measuring speed, movement speed, there are two speeds. So the movement speed, it will move very fast, is there, and then with measuring speed, it will go slowly and touch the workpiece. So that is the, so there are the two speeds. And then the distance between the workpiece and the fast movement point, so it will move fast to one point, then with small speed, slow speed, with the measuring speed, it will go and touch the workpiece. So that distance is called the safety distance. So these are all the measurement parameters. So once you decide all this, then we can, if you have only one part, we directly go to measurement, or if you need a program for repeated measurement, we'll make a program for the CMM. So these are the steps in CMM measurement planning. So define the datum. So how do you define the datum? Easy if given on drawing. So if the it is given on the drawing, it is easy. You have to either locate the workpiece surface on the table, or you have to probe on the points. If it is not given on the drawing, then it is a problem. So then operator has to decide which is should be the datum. Then again, different people, if they choose different datums, they will have different measurement results. Now we select the workpiece orientation. So how do we select the workpiece orientation? The workpiece should be accessible. The surfaces where we have to measure the holes and that we should be able to take samples. So that way we have to locate it. Okay, suppose we keep a hole, a blind hole, such that it is on the bottom surface, then we cannot have access to that hole. So we have to rotate it later. So as far as possible, we would like to complete all measurements in one position. That is the idea. So we have to ensure accessibility. So the CMM stylus should be able to move and enter the holes, etc. All this should be thought of. How will we keep it? So generally we would like to complete all measurements in a single setup if possible, but of course there is an exception where we have, because mostly the measurement accuracy is best when you measure along a single axis. So measurement uncertainty will be least when it's a single axis. So if you measure along an inclined angle to two axis, then the measurement uncertainty increases according to this general convention. So we would like to rotate it. So we like to rotate it every time and keep it. If there is only one line, we can rotate it along the axis and then take the measurement. So that is one option. Data features are probed, not used for holding. So data features should not be used for holding. So data we should locate. So if you hold on that surface, then you cannot have access to that surface. So the tightening nuts and bolts should not be on the data surface, but instead it should be probable. Align critical dimensions along CMM axis. So since maximum accuracy is obtained along the axis, the critical dimension should be aligned along with CMM axis. So select workpiece orientation, keeping all these points in mind. Then select work holding method. So how will you hold the workpiece? So we have to keep the workpiece on table and then hold it. So minimize distortion. So the holding, when you are tightening the nuts and bolts and to make it hold, it will apply force on the workpiece and it can bend the workpiece, can distort the workpiece. So that should be avoided. So minimize distortion. Should not constrain motion. So motion should not be affected. Motion of the probe. The probe and stylus all together should be moved. So if you keep it in some positions, then we will not be able to move the stylus or probe into that particular position. So what are the factors when deciding work holding method? So one is the measuring force. With what measuring force will you contact the workpiece? So the workpiece should not move when applying the measuring force. Actually, not only measuring force, but sometimes a slightly excess force will be there. So still it should not move. Okay, so whatever is the, strictly speaking, this should be the applied force. Then the weight of the part. So for a heavy part, we don't need any. Okay, so measuring force, the actual force while measuring is only 0.05 to 0.2 Newton. So that is controlled by the probe. You can select various probes. So low measuring force, high measuring force, etc. Probes are there. So if you choose low measuring force, it will be 0.05. High measuring force is 0.2. Medium measuring force may be 0.1 Newton, etc. But in many cases, initial probing force is higher than measuring force. So initial measuring probing force is higher than the measuring force. So what happens is when it comes into contact, there is some, it comes into contact with some velocity. So because of that, the dynamic forces come into play. So as you know, statically applied force or a dynamically applied force is double that of a statically applied force. So because of that, there will be sometimes higher force. So it should not just plan for only this 0.2 Newton, but should be at least double or triple this force, it should be able to withstand. So clamping should be able to withstand this initial impact. Okay, so that is about measuring force. Then weight. So whether we need clamping depends on this. For heavy items, self-weight is enough. For example, engine block and all. Once you place on the table, you don't need any clamping. But if it's a small plastic component, then it's a problem. So many times, especially this, when you are probing out the die for molding, then we have to make the components will be in plastic. So we have to inspect such components. First off, inspection or sample inspection. So there are sulfate will not be sufficient. So we have to have some additional method of coating. So you can use plasticine. What is plasticine? So children's toy play, magic play. So that can be used to fix the workpiece using this. Then wax can be used. So you can apply a drop of wax and fix the workpiece onto the table. Then there are magnetic or vacuum chucks. Because for aluminium and all, we can use vacuum chucks, but for steel magnetic chucks, maybe repair sheet metal parts and all, maybe light. So there we need such chucks can be used. Then mechanical clamps, so nut and bolt and such clamps can be used. Then fixtures, so sometimes we may have to make special fixtures to suit the component. And then adhesives, so that is another trick. So now we have that glue gun. So you use the glue gun to stick the workpiece onto the table, and afterwards you can remove the glue, they come off easily. So these are some methods to fix light components. Then choice of stylus. So stylus diameter has to be chosen. Stylus extension length has to be chosen. So larger the diameter, lesser the effect of surface finish. So filtering. So surface finish will get filtered off when you are using large diameter. So preferably we would like a larger diameter so that surface finish effects will not be there. But large diameter, what is the problem? So if you want to measure a small hole, the stylus should be smaller than that smallest hole. So we would not like to change the stylus as far as possible, because every change the uncertainty is increased. So even if or some you may have to recalibrate the stylus, even otherwise, even if it's already calibrated, then data is stored, but still there will be some uncertainty when you are unscrewing and reclamping. So it is better to avoid change of stylus. So choose the smallest hole, and before that, select the stylus. What is the policy adopted? Then another, okay, is the stylus extension. So that depends on the maximum depth which you can grow. So even for small diameters, when you go deeper, what will happen? This surface will hit the workpiece. So if you go this direction, workpiece will hit the stylus here. So that will also trigger the workpiece. So it is not only the stylus touching, but the stem touch also can cause triggering. So we should be careful that this touching will not happen. The depth, maximum depth is not exceeded. So we may have to choose a different type of stylus in this case. So ball stem clearance should be kept in mind. So it depends on the maximum depth which you have to probe. Probe qualification. So qualification parameters. The measuring speed should be similar to workpiece measuring speed. So if you plan to measure the workpiece at 5 meter per minute, you should do the stylus qualification also at 5 meter per minute. So the errors are balanced. So the measuring force, the deflection of the, because there will always be some deflection because there are very small parts. So the deflection in both are same, then it gets cancelled out. So if you calibrate with measuring speed 30 meter per minute and do the actual measurement 5 meter per minute, then there will be some variation because of the measuring speed difference. So ideally, the qualification speed and workpiece measuring speed should be same. Then during qualification also we can select large number of points. So during qualification we are measuring a sphere, standard sphere, and choosing a large number of points. So the larger number of points is always the better. But of course, the more number of points means it will take more time. Okay, so next is sampling strategy. What is sampling strategy? So, quartile pressure machines, they determine coordinates of points on the workpiece surface. So, we have to contact the stylus onto the workpiece, and the contacting point coordinates are determined. So, that is how this CMM function. So, after getting the coordinates, we have to compute the circle or distance between points, etc. So, yeah. Okay, I've given a sample problem in P2 server. Yesterday we discussed this. So, the sampling strategy problem is to decide how many points should be there on the workpiece. So, how many points should be sampled? For example, we want to measure the diameter of the circle. So, how many points should be sampled on the circle? And then, how should they be located over the surface? So, where should we sample? Shall I choose 3 points nearby? So, suppose we have a circle here. Shall I choose very nearby 3 points? Or should I go for faraway points? So, that is the sampling strategy. Nearby 3 points means easier. I'll finish my work easier. But uncertainty will be more. So, what is the ideal result? So, perfect measurement, what will be the result? What is the result obtained? Taking all available points on the surface. Suppose you sampled all the possible points, what result you get? That is the ideal measurement result. And assuming that all the points are correctly determined. That is, the CMM has no measurement uncertainty. So that means, whatever point, wherever we sample, we get that exact location. But actually, it is not so. But actually, you cannot take all available points, and there will always be CMM uncertainty. So this always causes some variation in measurement. So real measurement uses limited number of points. How many we have to decide? So, if you choose too many points, what is the problem? First, for a scanning probe, large number of points is not very difficult. But for a touch trigger probe, each time it goes, touches, comes back, etc. So, it is time consuming. So, the number of points is very limited. So, too many points will take. So after a certain number of points, more points will not give much change in the measurement result. So there is no need to take too many points. It's a waste of time. And too less points, what will be the problem? So the circle, even though we have designed it as a circle, during manufacture it may not be a circle. It may be oval or triangular or any shape. So if you want to capture the actual shape of the workpiece, then we have to take sufficient points for that. So, sufficient number of points such that the resulting measurement uncertainty is acceptable. So, it is connected with how much uncertainty you are willing to tolerate. So, already we have learned measurement uncertainty and conformity decisions, how measurement uncertainty will affect conformity. So, critical and stringent acceptance or rejection, etc. How do we decide all these things we have discussed? So, same things are applicable to CMM measurements also. So, these are the issues in real measurement. So, how do we select the points? So, one of the first standards on this was published in 89 by the British Standard, Standards Institution under the number BS772. So, there they suggested. So the mathematical minimum is this for each feature, and they recommended slightly more. Okay, for line, minimum is 2. 2 points will define a line in coordinate geometry, you know. They recommended 5 points so that there will be some safety because of the uncertainty in each point. For plane, minimum is 3, but they just suggested 9. For circle, there is minimum is 3, but they suggested 7. For sphere, they suggested 4, but recommended 9. So, But this is not a good recommendation. Actually, that is not enough. That is what my own research says. Okay. So what are the factors to be considered when deciding the number of points? So there are two main issues. One is the form error of the part. Second is the measurement uncertainty of the CM. So both have to be considered. So the ideal measurement result is obtained when CM measurement uncertainty is zero. But now we have to consider the effect of part form error also. So that is, the part shape is not circular but has some other form error. So what is form error? Again, we have defined in surface finish measurement. So the long wavelength irregularities. Okay, so if very short wavelength irregularities are considered roughness, medium is waviness, and the long wavelength irregularities are the form error. So how does part form error affect the sampling strategy? So let us consider the case of a circle, perfect circle. Mm-hmm. What is the theoretical minimum number of points required? Three. So three, if the circle is perfect, then any three points, however they are distributed, it will give same result. So if there is no form error, any three points will give same result. But if there is a form error, that is, it is not perfectly circular, for example, this is exaggerated, of course, suppose it's a three-lobed circle. Many times this happens. Why? Because if you are holding in a three-jaw chuck, so where it is held by the under the jaw of the chuck, that portion, it will be compressed during clamping. And when you release the clamping, it will come back. So here it will get projected upwards. So we get this short sort of a shape. So here, if you take three points here, the diameter will be this much. I don't know whether you can see. Okay, there's a small line passing through these three points. This is a small circle. It's not small, actually, this is a bigger circle. And suppose we are choosing three points here, then we get the circle as diameter. It's a smaller diameter. So the diameter you obtain depends on how you choose the points. Okay, so normally we are choosing points randomly. We don't know whether this shape is there or it's circular or it's oval, we don't know. Okay, we assume, okay, we should choose our sampling points so that whatever be the shape, we should get a good result. But that is, for that we should know the former, then only we can choose the number of points. If you don't know how much former is there, we cannot decide. So if the former is zero, any three points are enough. So if you want to capture the amount of former, how much is this form deviation? So for example, if this is the, okay, if you maximum inscribed circle and that's the minimum circumscribed circle, then this is the former or roundness error. So if you want to estimate the roundness error, then we need large number of points. If only diameter is required, we don't may not need that many points. So all these things are to be considered to decide the number of points. So what will happen if you choose less number of points under sample? So you are not able to capture all the high form error points. You capture only a few points. So the form error which you calculate will be lower. For example, if you are choosing only three points, how much will be the form error? Zero, because you cannot capture form error. Okay, then as you choose the number of points, the form error obtained will keep on increasing. So this is dangerous. You may accept a bad part if you choose less number of points. So then you will accept during inspection, but then when it goes to assembly, there will be problems. do not get assembled because of the former. Hence, since the magnitude of former depends on the process, how much will be the former? That depends on the manufacturing process. So from that, we can get some idea of how much radiation to expect. So process knowledge is essential. Your manufacturing process, how good is it, you should have some idea. Then only we can decide what will be the sampling, number of points to be sampled, sample size. So that is why a good inspector, he cannot inspect without knowledge of the machining process also. Should have some idea of how it is machined, which machine is used, etc. So in companies and all, the inspectors are there. They know which workpiece is machined in which machine, and even the operator. So if he knows that the operator is careless, he will inspect more carefully, etc. Many times such personality clashes do happen. So process knowledge is essential. So from now we talk about the sample size. What about the distribution? So what are the different types of sampling? So generally in sampling theory, we have simple random sampling, stratified sampling, cluster sampling, and systematic sampling. So these are four types of samples in sampling theory. So same thing is applicable to sampling by when inspecting with the CMM also. So what is simple random sampling? That is equiprobability sampling. So the simple random sampling is usually carried out with the replacement, but actually people will not do replacement because anyway you want to get more information. So suppose we have a population of n units and we have to choose a sample size n from this population of capital. If sample is selected such that every possible subset of n units has the same probability of being selected, so that is equiprobability sampling, then we can say it is a simple random sample. So how can we create a simple random sample? So suppose this is a population. I want to take a sample of students. So there are four classes. So this is a B.Tech course and we have first year, second year, third year, fourth year students are there. And I want to take a random sample from this population. So how do you take a random sample? So I have to make a list of all the elements and then choose a sample, random numbers. So in corresponding to that, those samples are selected. So that this is a simple random sample. So this method ensures that every sample has every element in the population has an equal probability of getting sampled. So when you buy mangoes, you might have noticed, how do they show you mangoes? They say take a sample, take a sample. They cut and give you also. Which one? So they would have selected a good mango and kept it at the top. And on the top, all the good mangoes will be there. So even in shops, you can see towards near the customer, they will keep all the good mangoes. So, and that will be very difficult to take. To be kept in arranged and beautiful, so they would not like to disturb. So when you are putting in the cover, they will take mangoes from the back. So that is not equiprobability sampling. So that is perhaps cheating. Okay, so this is simple random sampling. Then we have stratified sampling. Here we divide the population into strata or layers. So we draw simple random samples from each strata. So we divide into certain groups and then take random samples from each strata. And then we combine all these random samples from each strata to estimate the population parameters, to pull the information to estimate population parameters. So for example, if you have four classes, so you want to take a sample of 4, 5, 7. Okay, and say 8 students want to take a sample. We can take samples from each strata, say 2 from this strata, 2 from this strata, etc. But then all the strata is not of equivalent size. So we can give more weightage to the large strata. Okay, so we usually try to take sample size from each strata proportional to its size. So we divide the population into several groups. So from each group, we take samples proportional to its size. So this is stratified sampling. So stratified sampling will give, it will give a better representation of all the groups. So in simple random sampling, there is a possibility that all the samples may be only from one group. Sometimes it is very rare, but it has equal probability, sometimes it may happen. But in stratified sampling, that will never happen. Always we'll have at least one sample from each strata. So that way, stratified sampling will have lower uncertainty compared to simple random sampling. Another approach is cluster sampling. So this is very convenient. We divide the population into clusters, not strata, but clusters. Choose randomly a cluster or clusters as a sample. So you choose a cluster as a sample. For example, now I have four clusters. I choose any one group as a sample. All the elements in that sample or all the samples are from one cluster. Okay, so like I have 4 years, I want if I take a random student from these 4 years, I choose any 1 year, say third year, that is chosen random. Say I choose second year, and for second year I choose 4 samples using simple random sample. So this is cluster sample. So convenience is that you don't have to go to different classes, all 4 second year students are in one place, so easy to do. Easy to collect samples. So many times in election and all, to predict election result, people do this cluster sampling. So if you want to get sample from all over the country, then you have to take random samples from Kashmir to Kanyakumari and etc. But that is very difficult. So what we do? We choose a particular city, a representative city, and that is not chosen randomly. We choose a city which has always selected the winning party as a, which has always led to the result as common to the winning party of the overall winning party. That such a constituency is chosen as a sample, and in that constituency you do a simple random sampling or a stratified sampling, whatever. But idea starting point is cluster sample. So similarly, to get a sample of Kerala, you may choose a particular village as a cluster, and then you sample all people from that village or something like that. So that is cluster sample. Then we have systematic sampling. So in systematic sampling, we take at a certain frequency. So you choose the first sample randomly and then choose every next arc sample. So So in manufacturing and all, this is very convenient. You randomly choose one sample, then every 10 pieces you choose another sample, or every 20 pieces you choose the next sample. So that is a systematic sample. So if you are similar, if you are choosing a village in Kerala, you choose one village from, say, North Kerala, and then you go down, and as you go down, every 50 km you choose another village. So that is a systematic sampling. So along the main road you are traveling, and every 50 km you choose, wherever you are, there you choose one village and you ask some people. So maybe journalists do interviews like that about people. So they go to some places and ask the people, what do you feel about the climate? So that is the sort of systematic sampling. So the population, we make a list and we choose the first sample randomly. Then every six is chosen as a systematic sample. So, of course, how well the sample represents the population depends on how randomly you are choosing. So, if you deliberately mix it up, then you'll get very bad results. The probability we all will fail. Okay, so that is the basics of sampling strategy, the types of sampling. So same thing can be adapted to inspection also. So you can have uniform distribution of points. So points are uniformly distributed. So this is similar to systematic sampling. You choose the first point randomly, and then every, say we are measuring along a circle, take one point randomly. Then every 30 degrees you choose a sample. So that is a uniform distribution of points. Then random distribution of points. So you have to generate random numbers and select points randomly. And stratified sampling. So divide into regions. So a circle, you can divide into four quadrants. And each quadrant you carry out a simple random sample. Then it is stratified sampling. So, okay, for a plane, uniform sampling is like this. You choose one point randomly, then every, say, 50 mm, you choose one more sample. Like this, you get a pattern. But what is the problem with this? So, suppose there is some waviness, which is, our formula has the same wavelength as this spacing, what will happen? So suppose the surface is like this, and you choose points at every peak, the same frequency. Then you'll get the former as zero. But actually it is very much uneven. So such gross errors are possible if you choose only systematic sample. But of course, this the probability of getting this is very low because the first point is chosen randomly. So anyway, that's why we may not prefer totally systematic sample. We do prefer some slight variability in the second sample. So when the number of points is equal to number of lobes, then we have a problem. For example, three-lobe circles are common in centerless grinding, three-jaw chuck, etc. So, three-jaw chuck I explained how the clamping forces cause that three-lobed profile. Similarly, centerless grinding. So, this three-lobe profile has equi diameter. So, diameter is equal. So, in centerless grinding, many times you get that shape. So, when the number of points equals the number of lobes, or it is also a multiple of the number of lobes, then also we get. So suppose we choose 3 points here, we get large diameter. We choose 3 points here, we get a small diameter. So random sampling. So if we choose points randomly over the entire surface, then it is a simple random sample. But sometimes during random sampling, we may miss out some media altogether. So to prevent that, advantage is stratified sampling. So stratified sampling will give lower uncertainty. So subrandom sampling, so that is a form of stratified sampling only. So all subrandom samplings, the error decreases. Random sampling, the error decreases as 1 by root n. So as the number of samples increases, so we have learned sigma by root n. The uncertainty in x bar will reduce depending on 1 by root n. This proportional 1 by sigma by root n. Sigma of the population will be sigma of the sample by root n. So subrandom samplings, stratified sampling and all, the uncertainty is 1 by n. So it is better than simple random sampling. So stratified sampling and all is better. So people have suggested a pseudo random number sequence. There are several papers in the literature, people Hammersley sequence, etc. Sobol sequence, Hammersley sequence, which is not a random sequence, but such that it will cover the entire area in systematically. So this uncertainty is reduced, similar to stratified sampling. Important sampling. So wherever we find, think it is important, we sample more. So that is the idea of adaptive sampling. So instead of taking equal number of points from all over, or you divide into various strata and from each section you take equal number of points, you take more points from a particular region. So that is adaptive sampling. So if you find that the deviation there is more, from there you take more points. So that is the idea of adaptive sampling. So the main conclusion is that we have to know the process to decide on the sample. You cannot just decide based on without any information. So only our information about the manufacturing process will help us deciding a better sample. So one recommendation for a stable process is probe all parts with less number of points, say 10, and then for every 100 part use a large number of points, 1000. So for regular inspection we choose less number of points, just 10 points, but once in a while we take 1000 points, so that way the full form error is captured. So this is one technique recommended in the NPL guide. So I forgot to mention about that. So the NPL, there is a booklet on measurement strategy. Okay, so please go through that booklet. So this chapter is based mostly on that booklet. So there are several guides on CO partner metrology in the NPL site. So one on generally on partner measuring machines, one on sampling strategies are, one on probing is there. So we have to combine that. And again, for example, probing, I think a lot of changes have happened. More types of probes and all have come up, which is not there mentioned in that booklet. So something I have added. Of course, we have just gone only the names of the probes are there. So understand what are the different types of probes. Okay. So CNC machines usually have uniform spacing. So what is available in our CMM to make this uniform spacing only. Those adaptive sampling or stratified sampling, even random sampling is not available. So it is difficult to incorporate that code in a program. So this is a requirement which I have identified, but I don't know. But although statisticians understand the importance of randomization, common people don't really understand the importance of randomization. So that is a problem. So they think does all does not matter. So they don't give much importance to this. So that is why perhaps software with randomization capability are not aware that selects points randomly. So next is the effect of CMM uncertainty.
So we have talked about the point selection. So CMM uncertainty tends to overinflate former. Okay, so if all the points are on a perfect circle, the circle is perfect, but because of CMM uncertainty, the points will not be along a, will be different. It will not be along the original circle. So if there are more points, so these points will go up and down, and hence generally it will tend to overinflate the former. So this is was my subject of research. You can see my papers on this topic. So anyway, it is not very simple. It take afterwards some people are still said may not be applicable for many cases, etc. Okay, further research is required in this. So conclusion, use larger number of points as far as possible. Okay, so the British standard, which says 5 points for circle and all, is not correct. Okay, so especially if you want to get the former. So, and why do we inspect in CMs and all? Usually for critical component. If it's not a very critical component, then we don't even bother to inspect in CMs. So when you are inspecting CMs, definitely it is likely to be have some importance, that characteristic, and hence there is a necessity to use large number of points as far as possible. So again, time constraints, etc., will affect the decision. So, and again, the importance of the component, so criticality of the component, all these things have to be considered before deciding on the number of samples. So you cannot arbitrarily decide the number of samples. So that we conclude the sampling strategy. And then this part. Okay, define measurement parameters, measuring speed, movement speed, and safety distance. So these are the three measurement parameters. So measuring speed is the speed with which we contact the workpiece. So that's a slow motion. Movement speed is from one point to another point, it will move fast. That is the movement speed. So like rapid movement in rapid travels and CNC machines. And safety distance is the distance at which it stops from the distance, from the surface. So if you say it is 1 mm, if it is 1 mm away, then to move fast up to that 1 mm distance, and then slowly it will move with measuring speed and contact the workpiece. So these three are the important parameters in measurement. So programming. So the various steps are identify the user requirement. So what is to be measured? Then plan the measurement strategy, and then test the CNC program. So these are the steps in programming. So what does the user want? So how much measurement uncertainty is allowable? All this we have to decide, and then plan measurement strategy. So what is the number of points? How they should be distributed? Sampling strategy, and then other parameters, how the workpiece should be held, etc. All should be related to the user requirement. So you make a program. Okay, if it is one-time measurement, that is enough. If you are going to repeatedly measure, you are making a program and storing it, then you test the program and verify that. So nowadays software has that capability also. Just like in machining also, you have a simulation. So just like the CMM also,